We wanted to definitely go somewhere else. We knew it was time to try something different, and the idea of going to another country really appealed to us. And you know, we always liked Germany.
West Berlin was an enclosed space, but it was also full of interesting people.
We wanted to record an album in a place that was alive, not a place that was dead, like London.
Coupled with the fact that we've been on the road a lot and travelled around much more, there was a slight different feeling to the whole recording.
I think people were aware of the stories that people go to Berlin and make great records, or even artists go to Berlin and make great art. You don't realise that you actually go to Berlin, or certainly around that time, how creative and exciting and just weird the place was, because, you know, the walls still open. There were things you'd never thought of. You read about these things, but when you went there, you thought, oh, this is actually real. It is quite a grey, spooky place. You know, it's not Blade Runner continuously, but it was raining when I went.
Because, you know, we all worked in the same place, we all stayed in the same place, same hotel, we tended to go out together.
It was just crazy here, and we were again still very young, you know, and we sort of were treated not as cool as everyone else.
The idea of going to Hansa Studios, where sort of Bowie had worked, and, you know, Iggy Pop, that we were, Martin and I were certainly big fans of, you know, it was... I mean, it was, you know, we really had like a very, like a gang mentality then as well. It was us against the world.
Generelle Szene in Berlin war sehr intim, weil wir ja ringsrum eine Mauer hatten. Und durch diese Mauer war auch die Gruppe der Berliner eigentlich viel enger. Jeder kannte jeden, und abends auch in den Clubs waren immer so mehr oder weniger die gleichen Leute. Und da war Berlin eigentlich, hat richtig Spaß gemacht.
It suited very much the fact that they were having big success in Germany, and Martin had a German girlfriend and was talking German quite fluently. The whole thing seemed to fit quite well.
Berlin at that time was a very strange place, with a very special atmosphere, but you know, I think that if we'd have recorded that album in London, it probably would have turned out something similar.
We were getting into a bit of systems music and stuff at the time, and a bit of Steve Reich. I mean, I'd been into it for years, but I think the guys were getting into it a little bit. Alan was definitely getting into sort of Philip Glassy things. So I think there's quite a little bit of that knocking around in the background, you know.
You know, it definitely was supposed to be tougher. We didn't want to be wimpy. We wanted to make powerful, strong records with a lot of atmosphere. I was working with Einstürzende Neubauten, at that time in Berlin, who were like one of the archetypal metal bashing bands. That's not to trivialise what they do, you know. I mean, I'm a big fan of the lyrics as well and the guys as in general. But certainly a lot of what they were doing was taking found objects and striking them and making found objects into musical instruments with contact microphones and so on. And this is something we were already doing on Construction Time without knowing about Einstürzen and Neubauten. I met Neubauten again in Berlin, and I'd already made Halber Mensch with them when we came to Some Great Reward. And in my life, there was like a massive... I introduced Neubauten to sequences and sampling, and I was able to bring some of the work that I'd done with Neubauten to, you know, highlight some of the sounds and melodies and textures of the Depeche work. You know, so there was a big crossover.
Technology was moving really fast, and we used it. The idea of creating a new sound that you hadn't heard before was much more interesting to us. And really, it was the atmosphere that sound created which would be the template for the direction that the song would go in.
Daniel bought a synclavier, which opened up new avenues, and the sampling was so much better.
We weren't trying to be trendy or clever. We were just literally picking things up that were around us and saying, let's sample that, you know. And when you do that, you tend to come up with sort of hitting metallic objects, you know, because they seem to be all around you. And before you know it, you know, you're in the kitchen sampling knives and forks and scissors and stuff like that.
Okay, we've got this vague idea at the moment, which was used on the demo. We've got this vague idea at the moment, which was used on the demo. We've got this pebble, which we got from the mud. Anyway, the idea is to roll the pebble on this piece of metal along here, this window frame, thus making this sort of sound. And the idea is to take that sequence and to make an interesting rhythm out of it, and to sequence it all through the song, you know, so people dance.
You're just playing them back off the synclavier now, are you, Mark?
Yep. We've just recorded them, we're just playing them back to see what they're like. That was quite good, isn't it?
The whole thing about recording the Depeche was always trying to push it as far as we could. The songs were always strong, and then it was trying to put them into a really interesting and unusual and original musical kind of picture. And it was always that, trying to move forward, and Gareth was very good at pushing that.
Gareth was always a bit more than just an engineer, so full of ideas, more than just sort of sitting there just miking up a drum kit and saying, okay, off you go, play and I'll record you. He would have more radical ideas than that. Panzer Studio is actually four floors of studio, and we were in the top, fourth floor. Studio 2 had the great big recording space, and Gareth wanted to set up a PA system, and we had the tie lines going down from Studio 4 to 2, and we would send our sounds through this 2K PA, you know, at ridiculous audio levels.
The acoustics of People Are People and the sound of the beats and the big fills and things is all the sound of the rooms with the beats getting thrown around Hansa Studio, you know, three floors down for the bass drum. Snare drum one floor over, toms in another room over there kind of thing. The whole building was shaking.
Big sounding record, the biggest sort of, you know, in that sense, kind of biggest we'd ever made, and it seemed that it had something going for it.
It was taking social and political subject matter and making it quite poppy and commercial.
That stood out, everyone just thought that is amazing as a piece of, you know, mid-80s pop. I'm not saying it's Martin's best song ever or anything, but for what it was supposed to be at that time, that was amazing. I think he really hit the spot with that one. In a way, that's one of the good things about that video for me, is that kind of industrial edge that the Battleship video gives it reflects to me kind of in a decent way what we were kind of trying to do with the sound as we were making the record. Now you're punching and you're kicking and you're shouting at me.
I'm relying on your common decency. We just basically pressed play and just ran it. And everybody sang along, and it just seemed like it all sounded great even before we'd recorded it properly.
We thought it was a good song. Now we're not too keen on it. It's probably it's our biggest hit that we don't play.
Yeah, it overtook us somehow, you know. We knew it was that it's going to be very, very strong, because again, it's very easy. The track is very easy, the rhythm is fantastic, the melody, everybody can sing along.
Diese Wortspiele, People are People, war einfach das, was der Deutsche sofort verstanden hat. Und dadurch war hier auch der große Erfolg möglich.
People are People was a record that, as soon as we went to radio, was an instant addition to everyone's program.
People are People hit a tone with the public. It addressed racism, sexism, and acceptance of one another. And I think that it was something that also appealed to the mainstream pop radio programmers at that time, too.
It kind of took us by surprise that it went so big, you know. Monumental thing. People are People. It was an absolute smash.
Well, if you want me to do an interview while I'm doing it?
Yeah, you might as well, same time.
I'm trying to play a riff into the Synclavier sequencer. I'm going to play it wrong, though, so I'm not very good at this one.
Lie to Me. I don't know if we did the best version of that we possibly could have done, but you know, I quite like that as a song.
Lie to Me was, I think, one of the strongest songs that Martin had written up to that point. I thought it just had a great feeling to it.
It was one of the first tracks that had this chord change that I've used over the years, overused over the years.
Lie to Me was one that we played for a long time live, which I always really liked. I think really simple and direct, and we toyed with the idea of bringing that back on this tour actually.
Alan got a lot more involved in the production with Some Great Reward. I think that was, you know, a big turning point. Often, you know, Alan would sit in the studio with Daniel and Gareth till 2 or 3 in the morning. We'd be off at some bar or some club somewhere.
What are we doing? I'm trying to get the click in sync again.
We're trying to get the click in sync yet again.
He was really into it, and he was the one. He didn't get bored, and he was very happy to sit around listening and twiddling, you know, getting sounds right and stuff like that. No, he was definitely, in terms of being in the studio and sort of focusing in the studio on a kind of long, on a overall basis, Alan was definitely in there, you know.
My strength is really sort of orchestrator and sort of sound manipulator, if you like, and finding ways to get the best out of what's there rather than come up with the original ideas or the initial song ideas. So I just decided best leave that to Martin. He's good at it, you know, and he's much more prolific.